Okay. All right. Welcome, everyone, to Going the Distance, the Rocky Series podcast. I am your host, and with me is my other host, Katie. How are you doing?
Hello. I'm good. How are you?
Good. We are missing Kyle today. Kyle has quit the show.
Don't say that. People will be like, screw it. No, I'm
kidding. Yeah, no kidding. They're going to be. I'm out of here. No, Kyle's just said he has a Kyle cold. He has a COVID again. I think this is the third time he's had COVID since he's been on our show. We want him a speedy recovery, and usually we'd reschedule. Unfortunately, it's just this is my last recording, really kind of the last day I can really record before I sail for 4 months. We're not rescheduling. We're going to get this recording out. I'm going to miss you guys. Do not unsubscribe to the channel. Please don't. We got a lot of shows coming in from the other podcasts on this channel. The last of the Action Heroes Podcast Network. We've got Bruce Willis, Steven Seagal, Dolph Lundgren, Arnold Schwarzenegger, James Bond, and, of course, Rocky Minute and Slycast. So these guys will be releasing content in my absence. But Going the Distance, the Rocky Series podcast will be on hold for 4 months. Basically, you'll get a new episode around Christmas time.
It's a long time, Ryan.
I know. Because this is kind of a mini send-off episode, I'm going to speak plainly, and I'm going to talk to our small audience here and just say I'm a little frustrated, not at you or not at me, but at the coverage of Creed 2. I hate that it's getting split up because of my stupid sailing program. I really hate this. I really want to be on the Ramble series right now. I'm not going to lie to you. If I wasn't a sailor, I would already be on the Ramble coverage. That's all. I just feel...
stupid job.
Yeah, I know, and I'm excited to cover Rambo, and it's not that I'm excited to bury Creed, but I will say there's a little bit of insider behind the curtain of the numbers. The numbers aren't as big this year as they have been years past. One, maybe because of the consistency of the podcast, which is fine because I sail and I can't get an episode out every week, but also from Seiko, one of our listeners, as he so aptly puts it, he goes, Creed sucks, and he goes, you might not have people wanting to listen to the coverage. That's fair. And I know Seiko's in that camp where he's not a big... He actually listens to our show because he likes our coverage, but he's not a fan of the film. But he listens to us. But I don't know if we're strong enough to carry all those type of people. So I think people have abandoned the coverage because a lot of people don't think it's a Rocky film. What do you think?
Well, technically, it's not. As long as the Rocky character has a pretty significant part in the movie, to me, it is a Rocky movie. So, like, particularly for people who don't know, like, you know, if I'm just talking to a random person and they find out that I do this podcast, they're like, oh my God, like they joke. They're like, what are there, like five movies? And I'm like, no, there are eight, you know, like, so I'm like, oh, it's Rocky VIII, jokingly, but.
Well, it is.
Well, how do you feel about it?
It's the eighth film in the Rocky universe.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah,
it gets a little bit, I mean, not the nerd out here too much or belabor the point too much, but you know, like how many Iron Man films are there? Well, in theory, there's only three. Iron Man 1, 2, and 3. But Iron Man appears in...
Oh, yeah.
You know, if you not to mix Marvel and Rocky universes, but in a weird sense, that's what some people are saying. You could argue and say, well, there's three Iron Man movies. There's whatever number of Avenger films. There's a certain number of Spider-Man films, Doctor Strange. But they all mix each other up anyway. So there's a Marvel universe and DC universe. The Rocky character appears in eight films. But there are a lot of people who just say there are six Rocky films. So if you want to look at it that way, we are covering Creed 2 as we're doing. Like I told Seiko, and I'm going to tell our fellow listeners, we're not cheapening or lessening the Creed coverage. But there was a small part of me that kind of wished maybe at the beginning. And I don't know, maybe the listeners might, I don't know, maybe they'd want this. How do you think about after I come back from Christmas? I don't know. Maybe we'll wait for, hey, this is a poll. Maybe I have to take it to our page,
it to Twitter. Because
we'll have a 4 month break. And so people actually backlog a lot of episodes. I'm still getting messages from people, oh, I'm just listening to your episode now, which came out like a month ago or something. So people do listen to shows not right away when they come out. So I might ask over the 4 month break, when we come back, do you want us just to talk about Rocky and I guess the Dragos in this film? So only those scenes. So basically, if Rocky's in the scene, we're talking about it. And if the Dragos are in the scene, because I think they're worth talking about, obviously, we're talking about it. That would include the final fight because it's got, you know, or both fights. But I don't know. What do you think about that? What do you think about that? Or do you want to cover the non-Rocky and Drago sequences as the same in the same mode that we're doing right now, like scene by scene?
I can't really picture a ton of non-Drago or Rocky scenes or even like Marianne, like somebody from the Rocky universe aside, you know, seems to be in them. Although we could maybe just try and go faster, or something on those sections.
Yeah. All right.
Potentially. I don't know.
Well, that's good. We'll try that today, because actually the first thing we're getting to is just is Adonis and Bianca talking. So we'll play them out maybe a little bit longer. And then, yeah, but that's fair. What we'll do is maybe we'll play the scenes out longer and not interrupt the scene. So if it's a scene, even if it's 2 or 3 minutes, play the audio. And then we'll just talk about the scene, and then we might get through things. I would say quicker. I'm trying to streamline it. I'm not trying to make it less. I'm just trying to streamline the product. Okay.
Yeah.
We've got some emails. What? Okay. So let's roll right into it, Katie.
Okay. This one is from Patrick Mentel. Hello, Ryan, Kyle, and Katie. I'm in the middle of listening to episode 7, and there was a little discussion if in the real world, Adonis would have been allowed to accept Victor's challenge for a fight. Let's assume that Adonis holds the belts of all 4 main sanctioning bodies. These would be the WBA, the WBC, IBF, and WBO. Since the WBO was founded in 1988, no real boxer managed to accomplish holding all 4 belts due to title defense obligations, managers not being able to agree on a fight, or just losses in certain fights. Right now, Anthony Joshua holds the WBA, IBF, and WBO belts, with Tyson Fury being the WBC champ after defeating Wilder. If Fury wins the rematch against Wilder in October this year, there could be a big showdown between Fury and Joshua for all the belts next year. Both fighters want the fight, so this very well could happen. But back to Adonis versus Victor. I will try to summarize what the rules of the WBC say. Champions shall defend their titles either in a voluntary or mandatory defense against a challenger if the challenger is one of these things. Any of the top 10 rated contenders of the WBC is rated 11 to 15 if the WBC approves, is a former world champion, is the champion of another boxing organization recognized by the WBC, or is a champion or a highly rated boxer of another weight division. All these things Victor is not, or probably not. But the rules say that under special circumstances and with the approval of or ratification by 2/3 of the Board of Governors, a contender not otherwise listed in one or more of the above categories can fight for the title. So there you have it. The fight between Adonis and Victor would have been possible in real life. I hope this little boxing history mail was not too boring. All the best, Patrick. No, that was like super informative. Thanks, Patrick.
Yeah. Not much more to add. I think if Kyle was here, he would probably have some sort of a boxing background add, and I think he'll find that interesting. So again, I'm sorry Kyle's not here, but yeah, thank you for explaining that what happened in the film is at least that's legit. So the question was, I think I brought it up. I said, could Victor just say, I want to fight somebody for the belt? And basically, long story short, looks like it's an easy workaround at the very least. So yeah, if you get challenged, you gotta fight. All right.
The next one is from Barry Walker. It says, hi, Ryan, Kyle, and Katie. Great work as always by you three. Just wanted to drop a quick email. Sorry, not to the standard of some of the more regular emailers. Listening to the podcast has often given me different perspective on parts of the films, especially with the integration of the film sound into the podcast. This is possibly none more so than Creed 2. I really liked the proposal part and never really picked up on when Donnie says, I didn't know if I would win. Maybe I'm overthinking it, but this feels like something Rocky would have said way back when and added to a more likability factor of Donnie. That's a good point.
Yeah.
He says, I found the recent chat, or maybe not so recent, depending on when you get this, on Sly and his other characters interesting. I am defo in the Kyle camp. If I understood him properly, in that it's Rocky playing Sly and the other characters. I think I'm confused. Oh. Like, I feel like, did Kyle say it feels like Rocky playing Sly and not the reverse?
Yeah, good question. Sorry, that was from Barry?
Yeah.
Okay. This is another one. Kyle, why aren't you here? How dare you're cold?
Yeah.
I'm going to pause it really quick. Just wait 1 sec.
Recording stopped.
Just wait 1 sec. All right. Well, I guess you guys heard me say we're pausing the pause the show. I think we just figured out Katie's mic, so she's gonna sound even better now. So yay!
Hopefully. Sorry about that, everyone.
We're total professionals, of course. So.
So Barry goes on to say, a big no for me was Rocky calling Robert Bobby. Mm. Honestly, this drove me mad. I always believed that Sly loves the character as much as us, but this is just lazy and offensive. Yes, there's probably 1,000 reasons why, but sorry, I just do not take it. As Rocky fans, we have learned
to be forgiving with many time and memory lapses, but this one is too far. Does Sly and the Creed franchise just think we will eat any old crap? We talked about this and I found it to be out of left field as well. And I was like, what the hell?
Odd. It does seem odd that he calls his son Bobby. Maybe he's thinking of Bobby De Niro and Copland. I don't know.
That was first and only time he says it. And then you'd think that they would have caught it or that he would have caught it. But yeah,
it is weird. And I know, I'm sure if Sly was here, he would say, a lot of directors or writers will say, oh, you fans know more. I get it to a degree, but it's like, you're the author of the, it's weird that the author, the creator of the series and franchise, and I would assume Sly is in the editing of a lot of these films, right? Like he's part of the editing and you would think that at some point he'd be like, why are we calling him Bobby? I've never done that before. And nobody else on the crew said anything like, oh, this is the first time you referred to him as Bobby. Are we okay with that?
Also, he wrote it. Yeah. Come on, Sly.
We expect better. You know. All right.
We do. We very much do. And okay. So then Barry says, almost done. Talk about leaving on a bombshell, Ryan. ... And suggesting you may revisit some of the films again. No pressure, but very excited.
Yeah. Anyways, I've got mixed feedback on that. Good, not good and bad, but all have been good. From everyone that I've talked to has said that they would love to hear, and I think it's not me, but they would love to hear, especially Katie and Kyle with me, about some of the Rocky. And I think what we'll do is I'll meet people halfway. There's two ways we can do this. And some people have also said we should do it this way, is that we could do like a nonstop commentary of the film. So if you wanted to, you could put on Rocky 1 and all the films. And we just sit down for that 2-hour period and just talk about the film.
Yeah.
That's one way. So it's a watch along. So you'd have to call it like a watch along episode. There's that option. There's also just, I'm ready to move on. And I'm kind of leaning towards that. And I'm sorry, but I don't know yet. But I'm a better podcaster now than I was when I started. The first three seasons were good. I just feel like, yeah, it would be kind of nice to go back. But I'm also anxious to do the Ramble series. So I don't know. We also talked about going back and doing the Ramble series at the same time, like alternate. This might be like a longer process because I'm still going to do about every 2 weeks, even when I return. So we could do like maybe not as detailed, but because I don't think the Ramble ones are going to be as detailed. I don't. There's just not enough going on because you got 20 minutes of explosions in a row. There's not really much to talk about. So now that I'm saying it out loud, maybe that would be the way to do it. Just do a Rocky revisit.
It's not super dialogue-y, Rambles.
And there's not a lot of character study, really.
Yeah.
The first one has the most, but the rest of it is just kind of like, what was Rambo's thoughts while he was tearing out a guy's throat? Well, that's just what he did. It'll be interesting. We'll see.
So he says, anyway, safe sailing, Ryan, and Kyle and Katie, keep well until the next episode.
Thanks. Good timing on that one. Yes, we will. Thank you. That was Barry, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I think he's our truck driver, the long haul truck driver. Anyways, if he's not, I'm sorry, but I'm pretty sure that's who it is.
Or maybe it was Donald.
No, I don't think Donald is. I don't think he is.
No, okay. I'm getting people confused. I apologize. Okay, but the next email is from Donald.
Yeah.
He says, dear Ryan, Kyle, and Katie, quick correction to my last email. Sly's Samaritan movie comes out June 5th, 2021, not in December. So by the time you read this on air, it will be out and hopefully getting rave reviews.
Okay, so that's not his fault. This is a little bit older, this email. Like, so it's about a month old or so. So as of today's recording, the news came out that it's not getting released till the summer of 22. It's officially getting released summer of 22, I think August of 22, which kind of worries me. Maybe they're just waiting for theaters to be fully kind of, because, you know, that's the biggest draw. Yeah, we'll see. Hopefully that just means maybe they're going to work on the special effects. They're going to work on the editing. They're going to work on the music because all the principal photography is done. So now it's just decorating the film with music, score, special effects. And I know COVID slowed things down. So yeah, I'm sure it'll be fun. It's just going to be weird that in 2022, Sly will be 2 years older than he was at that point than he was when he filmed it. But
yeah. So he says, I had December in mind last time because the film was originally scheduled for December 2020.
Yeah.
I must say the lack of promotion for this movie has me concerned about its quality.
Yeah.
Yeah. Also, since my last email, though, the sale of MGM to Amazon has gone through. So maybe MGM are now just pushing out their last theatrical obligations with as little effort as possible. I just hope the film is good.
I'm worried.
I haven't heard that much about it, to his point.
Yeah. Like, not even a teaser.
I mean, I even seek it out. Yeah.
You should have a teaser even because they got principal photography done. Just some sort of, just even a 20 second, 30 second. It's not too early. They do teasers all the time a year before a film comes out.
I will say I haven't been to a movie in the movie theater in forever. I know a lot of times they have mini trailers, just right. quick little like coming.
But it'd be on YouTube.
August 2020.
It'd be on YouTube. Yeah. It's not out yet. Okay. There's no trailer right now.
He says, Sly as an original superhero is such an appropriate final punch for MGM to throw. When I think of MGM movies, I think of Roaring Lion logo, right. the Rocky films, and A Christmas Story. RIP to the studio, Donald. P.S. In my last email, I wondered if Amazon might continue the Rocky universe. But now I have a better idea. They also now own Over the Top. Imagine the titles, guys. Still Over the Top. Over the Top, Double Elimination. Focused on the Sun. Over the Top, Mike Hawk. Actually, I'm kidding. I just really wanted to make Katie say Mike Hawk.
Oh, boy. You got it. She got you.
I'll do it again. Mike Hawk. Go F yourself, San Diego. Brian Granko. Or no, that was Donald. Sorry. Yeah, the next email is from Brian.
Yeah,
the next
one's from Brian. That's right.
That PS was Donald. So actually, I don't hate the idea of 35 years later, Over the Top sequel. But not with the kid.
No.
Not with the kid. Yeah.
That's one of my least favorite Sly films. So
I know it is, but I love it.
Oh, boy. All right. What's the next one? Brian Granko.
Brian says, hello, everyone. Thanks for reading all my emails during the Creed series. I'm age 68 and probably one of the oldest members that listen to your show. On a previous episode, Ryan asked what I did for a living. My last job before I retired was driving an airport shuttle van to Philly and New York airports. One time around the year 2000 or so, I picked up a passenger a few blocks from Mickey's gym, and she told me back in the 60s that used to be a bar called Blue Moon. The only celebrities I met doing this were Jim Belushi and Frank Gorshin. And yes, I got both of their autographs. Frank used to play the Riddler on that old Batman TV series in the 60s. He mentioned working with Burgess Meredith, who was also in the series as the Penguin.
Nice. Yeah.
Ryan mentioned about me getting back to him about Angie in the bar scene from Rocky Balboa. You were right about her being the B word. In a DVD commentary, Sly talks about her growing up about a block from the new Lucky 7 Tavern and living that kind of life. Sly goes on to mention the bar thug's wife came in, which I assume is from the local casting office, and suggested her husband for the part. His name was Louis Giansante. Getting back to Angie, she mentioned that they had to redo the scene the next day. Maybe she meant the deleted scene. For that, she was paid about $1,200. Not bad at all. According to her, because of the lifestyle she had growing up, Sly set her up with a $4,000 a year trust fund for life. Hey, where do I sign up? Yeah, no kidding.
When I read that, I was blown away. And I'm not doubting Brian in that he's making this up, but I'm just wondering, I'm doubting if it happened. Like, maybe that's what Brian heard, but I'm doubting this girl is getting that much money still from Sly.
I mean, $4,000 a year isn't, like, that's nothing to Sly, but just some random, not even nice, seemingly nice person, if Brian's confirming that she wasn't super nice. Why? How many of these trust funds, if that were true, how many of these trust funds does he have? Like, every movie he's on, some random extra, I don't know. So Brian says, I sent her a message a few times on Facebook, but I didn't get a reply. One suggestion I have for a guest on your show is Chris Ellison, who is the ref in Creed. He's on Facebook and lives here in the Philly area. I met Chris about 4 years ago when he and I were extras in a Bryan Cranston, Kevin Hart film made here called The Upside. Mm-hmm. I haven't seen that yet.
No, I haven't either.
Well, so I love Bryan Cranston. Mm-hmm. And when Kevin Hart first came out, I liked him. But now his shtick gets old real quick.
Sure.
You know, anyway.
I got you. I agree. I hear you.
Brian is saying, Kevin actually grew up near Max's Steaks. When you get to the Rambo series, I'll have to brush up on the films since the only one I saw in its entirety is part 5.
That's weird.
Wow.
I find that weird. So he saw the last one in its entirety? That's kind of a weird place to start the franchise.
Well, probably because it just most recently came out.
True. But I mean, as someone who's, and this is not a slight on Brian, it's just an interesting journey that his, you know, he's 68. I would have assumed it by this time of being a Sly fan. But there are people that, I've said this before, there are people who are Rocky fans that are not Rambo fans, and people who are Rambo fans who are not Rocky fans. Kyle's one of them, for example.
They're very different.
I'm a Sly fan, so I see everything he does. So, and I enjoy both the Rocky and Rambo for different reasons. Rocky for the heart, for the drama, and Rambo for the blood and guts and adrenaline. slide to his credit, and I'll say it 100 times, he does an amazing job making you forget that he plays both characters when he does one or the other.
I don't know if anybody, I don't think anybody else has done that, and it would be really hard. It's a near impossible feat to pull off.
Well, that's what I mean with Harrison Ford. We've talked about this. With Harrison Ford, when he does, when he does Indiana Jones and Han Solo, it still feels like a very Harrison Ford-y. So that's what I mean. Like, those are two completely different characters in the sense of they're different universes. You know, one's kind of in reality, one's in a galaxy far, far away. Yeah, Sly, to his credit, really makes you forget that he plays Rocky when he does Rambo and vice versa. So that's a good job on Sly's part. Absolutely.
Of course. That's a wrap. Keep punching, Brian. So nice. Those are the emails.
That's all of them. Okay. That's everything?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, there we go. That wasn't bad.
Yeah.
Kyle would say at this point, we're wasting too much time on emails. And so he always fades out on – well, he fades out on most of the show, but I love you, Kyle. You know what? He never listens, so I could crap talk him.
Totally could.
Yeah.
But then watch. This is the one episode.
That's right.
No.
I know. We love Kyle. This episode will be lessened in some ways – because we don't have any kind of like real world boxing knowledge that Kyle always drops on us. So bear with us, ladies and gentlemen. But without further ado, we can roll into the film. The last place we left off, of course, was Rocky and Adonis outside of Rocky's house. Adonis says he wants to fight Victor. Rocky's not going to support or train him. And they have a bit of a falling out. And Adonis is going to continue his journey without Rocky. And Adonis has come home angry.
T, are you okay?
Rocky, man.
Rocky what?
He ain't training me for the fight.
Wait, you're taking the fight?
All the shit that we've been through. He gonna leave me high and dry. That's bullshit. I took care of him when he had cancer. He could have been dead, B.
Sure he has his reasons.
Oh, yeah, like what?
Hey, Ryan.
Like what?
Yeah, go ahead.
Maybe it's just on my side, but the video's not. Or is it just dark? On your side,
oh,
too.
Okay. No, it's showing up on my side, but I bet you it's Netflix is doing their protection thing where I bet you it won't show.
I'm getting subtitles.
Yeah, okay. Interesting.
Which is fine.
Okay. Yeah, so on my end, it's recording fine. That's interesting because Netflix has this like software where you can't screenshot and stuff. So I bet you it's because we're using Zoom. It's not letting me share it with you. But if you're okay to hearing the dialogue and stuff, on my end, it doesn't cause any problems. Okay.
Yep, that's fine.
Okay. Adonis has come home. He's angry, of course. And even what I like here is Bianca even like, you're taking the fight? She's not even quite on board with the idea that he's taking the fight. And then
I wouldn't be.
And then Adonis goes, when he had cancer, I cured him. Like, come on.
Yeah, I don't particularly care. This is an unlikable Adonis moment.
Yeah, we're back to a little bit of a cocky, unlikable. Yeah. We understand. But here's the thing. We know he's angry. We know that Rocky didn't mean to, but he kind of hit him where it hurts with his own ability to box, his ability to beat Victor. And when you're faced with the truth of who you are, like if I were to go up to you and say, you just had a birthday for the other day. And if I said to you, oh, Katie, you look like you aged 10 years since your last birthday. Now, that might be like, what? That's kind of a mean thing to say, but I don't think you would believe it. I don't think you would actually think that's actually what you look like, right? And what I mean by that is if it wasn't true, it might be like that's a rude thing for Ryan to say, but I'm actually going to go about my day the same way I did before Ryan said that rude comment. So you'd be more upset that I might have been rude, but you don't believe it. So you're not going to be angry about it by the time you get home or go to work the next day. So this is what I'm getting as Adonis heard from Rocky, look, I don't know if you can beat this guy, and I'm just telling you the truth. And then Adonis believes it, though. I think he's recognizing within himself, like, not only was, and Rocky wasn't being rude, mind you, but he was saying something that's hard to hear. And Adonis's response was, yeah, I don't think he can either. I think he kind of recognizes he might not have the ability to beat this guy. Are you still there?
Sorry, I was muted. My dog was barking. Yes, I think you're right.
Yeah, and happy birthday, by the way. I don't know if people hear this, will be a couple weeks old, but how old are you now?
It was a big one.
Is this the 40? I almost hesitated to say 40 because I was like, oh man, maybe she's turned 30 and I'm going to really screw up here. But I know you're not, because what you told me with your history in the movies, like, there's no way you're, I would say only 30, but yeah, so you turned 40. Mm-hmm. Well,
yep.
I'm 46 in October. I hear you. You know, I'm not going to lie to you, Katie, 40's rough. In some ways, because you really are hitting your midlife. I'm not trying to crap out of here. Anyone that's turned 40 can recognize. It's the first birthday or the first decade, and I'm now almost 6 years into it, where it's the one where you're like, oh, I really am midlife. And like, I don't think I'm going to live to 90.
Yeah, you will. So the way that I've made it okay for myself is that I'm still considering myself a young person, and only when I hit 45 or so, because I assume I'll live to be 90.
Well, that's fair.
Or more.
That's
or
long, no, you know. Yeah, but we're kind of midlife-ish at the very least. Like,
You're right. I'm splitting hairs, for sure.
You are. In a good way. You're being very positive. Yeah, and for the record, 40 is young, 45 is young, because in a lot of ways, we're living longer now. I mean, I look at my parents, they're in their 70s, early 70s, and I think to myself, like, 30 years from now, I'll be 2 years older than my dad is now. So that's a lot of life. I don't look at my dad, I come from healthy stock, I don't look at my dad as some decrepit, feeble old man. Like, you know, it's like a Sly. You know, Sly is 75 himself, so... There's a lot of life left to be lived. However, you're doing just fine. You are successful. You are healthy, and I wouldn't. Yeah, you make 40 look good where there are some 40-year-olds were.
Well, thank you. It is, in addition to us living longer, you know, my friends and I, just because I saw a lot of people this weekend, and we were talking about how when we were kids, 40 did seem really old,
sure.
Like really old, or even when we were 21. It's just a saying, but 40 is the new 30, and 30, you know, like, so I'm like, oh, I'm okay until I'm 60, maybe.
Well, yeah, I saw your pictures with your friends. My goodness, what an attractive group of women you hang out with. Boy, oh boy. Well, I guess birds of a feather flock together. If Kyle was here, he'd be rolling my eyes right now because he always gets uncomfortable when I look, to all the men who are listening, if you are in Katie's age range and you are handsome and have some money, not that she needs your money, but just helps you makes you more eligible. Katie is, she's single. My goodness, people, you have to understand, she is an attractive woman. She's successful. She's self-reliant. Yeah. But I will say that I actually got a little bit of a stalking crush on one of your friends. I saw one of your friends like, oh my goodness, what an attractive woman.
Which one?
Jennifer.
That's hilarious. Well, she's super fit. That's funny because she is closer. She's probably one of my older friends. I'll just say that. Like, so she looks really good.
Well, she's
because
fantastic.
She's
I saw her and I said to myself, boy, if I was a single guy, yeah, I would have been like, hey, can you give me Jennifer's contact info? Yeah, I was smitten by the pictures. I'm not going to lie to you. So you can tell her that. You can say this old guy over here, hey, found her.
I will, because she's also going to have a big birthday.
What?
Yeah.
Really? Jennifer, the one that starts last letter?
Okay.
First? Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, she's going to have a big birthday in March.
Mm-hmm. Kudos to her.
Right?
Yeah, good for her. Anyways, yeah, so again, if you want to creep Katie's Facebook, you can see it. Okay, all right, so we're delaying this film, I think. I apologize. All right, let's go to the next scene. I'll tell you what's happening here. So Adonis is putting his bags into a car, and he's ready to go train. Is this Robert Tepper singing?
Well, I was digging the song. I can't actually see what's happening, but the song... I don't know if Nas is one of the singers.
Okay, there you go.
You know, he's from my era, but he's a really good rapper.
Oh, cool. Yeah, he's it's a stupid joke, and I couldn't get it on time. Never mind. He's Nas on my list. That's stupid. I can't even do it. Okay, so there looks like Bianca and Adonis have. Oh, they're flying to L.A. Oh, this is a good scene coming up here. So they're.
Oh.
Yeah. Here we go. And they're just looking. Oh, they look at the new house they're going to move into.
No. I love it.
Me too.
Want just a little piece of that room for the studio.
That works. It's all you. What's wrong?
I don't know. Maybe I'm just a little tired from the flight.
Well, we don't have to go out. We just stay in, order some food.
No, baby. You have to tell her.
All right, so he has to tell Mama that he's going to fight Victor. This is a great scene. So I guess there's no scenes we can really not watch, is there?
So how's the music?
Oh, Donnie didn't tell you? Dang.
I forgot.
Oh, yeah, I signed.
Hello?
Dang. Yeah, it's great. The record label really hit the ground running, too. I'm up for festivals this summer.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
So how's Rocky? He didn't want to make the trip?
You know how he is, with the traveling.
interesting. It was kind of cool to hear Marianne ask about Rocky. You know, like, why is it Rocky here having dinner with me and you guys? At this point, she wouldn't know that Adonis is fighting or training, right? They're gonna buy a house in L.A. to be next to Mama Creed. I guess in this universe or in this movie, we're led to believe that Rocky really is like a father figure to Adonis. And she's kind of asking how come Rocky didn't make the trip. And, you know, but Adonis is saying, you know how he is with traveling and what have you. But he's not there because he's not going to be training Adonis for anything.
That's true. The traveling thing is new because he used to travel all the time.
No, yeah. He would travel to Russia, for Pete's sakes. He traveled Rocky III. So he traveled to L.A.
What did they use for the excuse for he just doesn't like to travel anymore or doesn't like to be far from home anymore?
Maybe. Because he's running the restaurant, maybe. Maybe.
Later,
he takes the train
or something, yeah.
So that is weird because We never got any kind of inkling. He didn't take the train to Russia. In fact, we know he flew in Rocky 5 because he flew back in Rocky 5 at the airport. So there's never been given an indication that he's opposed to flying or traveling. I guess we've learned in this episode, in the 8th film of Rocky, that he doesn't like traveling. We just found out now.
Mm-hmm.
Which is weird again, too, because you watch Rocky 3, the montage at the beginning of Rocky 3. He's going all over the world.
Mm-hmm.
Germany and what have you. Everywhere. Okay, whatever.
I'm sure you already guessed it, but...
Oh, yeah. I already know. All the salt, shiny hair, glowing skin. How far along are you?
Why you think? You think?
Uh-uh.
We couldn't even. Oh, that's.
Mama got jokes. Okay. No, I'm not.
No, we
couldn't. All right.
This scene is actually really well done and very realistic.
I agree.
Very realistic too, but it's also going to get very more uncomfortable because she's just told Mama Creed that she's got a record deal that, well, according to Marianne, that she's pregnant. I think she is pregnant, isn't she? So Marianne was right that she is pregnant.
Yeah, well, I wondered if it was foreshadowing when they were looking at the house and he said, what's wrong? And she's like, oh, I'm just a little tired. Probably from the flight.
She is pregnant.
Because she's pregnant.
Right. Yeah, and it's been a while since I've seen the film, like a couple of years. But I know she gets pregnant, has a baby in the film. It's not that. It's just I couldn't remember exactly when it's discovered. It's kind of cool that Marianne actually does reveal that she actually calls them out for being pregnant, but they actually don't know it officially yet, the couple. But what makes it kind of sad is what's coming. So all this good news, and then Adonis is about to drop the truth bomb of why they're here. Oh, she casually spits out the wine. Oh, it's not yet. Okay, my bad. It's not yet. They're in the bathroom. Peeing on a stick.
I wish you messed up.
That's right. Oh, yeah, he tells her later. I remember.
Mm-hmm.
It's two little lines.
Two lines. What does that mean? Two lines. Well, maybe it's broke.
Those things are pretty accurate. Trust me, I know.
That's crazy.
Yeah, well, I don't know. Say. Maybe, I don't know.
You did say you always wanted kids.
Yeah, but I didn't say so soon. I don't know if I'm... if we... ready.
No offense, but if any couple's ready, it's these millionaires. Like...
I'm not having kids, so I think right. I have the luxury of saying this, but they always say, if you wait till you're ready, you'll never do it.
Exactly.
Or that's if you wait until you can afford it, you'll never do it. Like, even... they probably think they don't have money. But what I was going to say is I remember when I watched this like the first time, and it still comes up, is that my immediate thought is for her. She just got done telling Marianne that she signed a record deal and she's going to be going to like all these festivals. Well, not anymore. You're not. Sucks to always be the woman.
Right.
His career is going to be just fine.
That's right. Well, yeah, good point. Because, yeah, I mean, nobody wants to see a pregnant woman on stage.
Well, no, I mean,
I know, it's a joke
it does happen. It's just that,
it's a joke.
It's just that she wouldn't likely be able to.
No, at the point, there's parts of the pregnancy later on. In fact, there, I forget which singer it was, but a couple of famous singers, of course, who performed pregnant.
Mm-hmm.
It comes to a point where, yeah, you're going to take some time off. But again, that's what I mean, is they have the money and the means to hire help. You know, so she can actually do a lot of the turn. You're only out. Women are quite resilient, and I've seen it many times myself in my personal life. So it's amazing how quickly a lot of them get back on their feet. After having a baby, they're literally walking out of the hospital the next day. So mothers and who have children. They're amazing resilient. So it doesn't take that long to recover. It takes longer to recover from surgery than it does from delivering a baby. You'll be not that you would be surprised, but those who aren't familiar with births, it's actually I was surprised until I saw it happen. How quickly they just bounce back and just they're up and about.
Yeah, I mean, assuming everything like goes,
of course, barring any. Right. Complications and bed rest. Yeah, and, well, yeah, of course. Yeah. But the average pregnancy with the average woman, they're usually discharged from the hospital the next day. They're like, that's insane. Have fun. Take care of the kid at home. See you later. Yeah, I know. It's crazy. Trust me. It's crazy. We had twins for our last kids, and they had to stay in the hospital for a little bit because they were born a little bit early. And when we brought them home, they were so tiny. The daughter was 4 pounds.
That is tiny.
I can't believe it, you know. And the son was 6 pounds. And so that 10 pounds of baby that we brought home out of two kids. And it's so tiny. Like, you bring home these little things, you're just like, oh my goodness, they're just look like little porcelain dolls. It's scary in some ways. I hate the first 6 months because you think everything they're going to do, they're going to die. I don't know. Anyways, all right, that's morbid. here's the thing. I actually want to bring this up. This was from one of our listeners on our Facebook page. So I want to thank everyone that writes us. We get a lot of people commenting on our Facebook page or on Twitter. So I want to thank you guys who do that, who interact through those mediums. I don't usually read them out very often, but this gentleman's name is a little bit tough to pronounce. Let me just get it here. I apologize. This is great radio, eh? Well, let me just play this. We'll keep playing this. I'll find his comics. It's something I want to talk about.
Let's get right in here.
That was sweet, I will say. That was a very likable moment of Adonis.
No, he's good here again. I mean, I'm not going to criticize him as a father or a husband. The character. I mean, he loves his wife, and he's excited to have a kid. He's not saying, oh, crap, I don't want to do this type thing. No, let's do this. You know, he wants to do it all, and he's willing to do it all as a husband, father, and fighter. And yeah.
Did you tell her family yet?
She's on the phone with her aunt right now.
Oh, that Bianca's a good one. Why she agreed to marry you, I do not know.
I don't know either.
Oh, it's good to have you home.
Ma, that fight between me and Ivan Drago's son, I'm going to take it.
Okay.
That's it?
What else is there to say?
So that doesn't bother you?
Oh, you think this doesn't bother me? You're a grown man. It doesn't matter what I or anyone else thinks. If you want to fight this man, that's your business. You don't need my blessings. Clearly don't have Rocky's.
Rocky don't get it. I wasn't his dad. It changed my life.
Your life?
You telling me you don't miss him?
Excuse me. Do not try to make this about me, and don't pretend that it's about your father. You became the world champion without him.
Why don't I feel like him?
If your father was here, he would tell you he didn't feel like it either. I just hope you'll be here for your child.
Oh, boy.
There was a lot in that scene.
There was a lot in that scene. She tagged on right away. Obviously, Rocky doesn't approve, so she figured out very quickly that Rocky's absence was a sign of him not wanting to be a part of this fiasco.
Mama Creed is very insightful.
Mm-hmm.
She knew Bianca was pregnant. Yeah. All these things. Yeah.
Yeah, no, that's true. No, she's got it all figured out. She's a wise sage, as they say. She's right. You can't make him do anything. What's she going to say? Don't do it. She's seen what that does to the fighters if you don't have the support. Like, don't do the fight. So already she's like, well, you're going to do it. You're going to do it. She just said, though, I hope you're there for your daughter. Now, it's kind of crazy to think just because the dad got killed by the father of the guy you're fighting doesn't mean you're going to get killed necessarily in the ring. But it's kind of a, I would say, that part doesn't always sit well with me because it's like, well, because it's like she's basically saying, I hope you don't die. Like, come on. That's a little dramatic. One doesn't have to do with the other. The chance of him being killed in the ring in 2018 with the way the refs are done. Think about real world boxing. How many deaths minus the Creed death has there been in the rings that I'm even aware of? I don't know. I'm sure Kyle might be able to tell us, but it can't be that common to even have that.
No, but I mean, I don't think it was common to die in the ring even in the 80s. You know, like it doesn't usually happen, if ever, the actual ring. But it, again, it is a movie. And I guess the way that you're right. The likelihood isn't there, but it's possible. And it is exactly what killed. He's in the same exact position with the same people, the same family that his dad was when he was not yet born. If anything were to, maybe that was like her way of getting in her one last argument. If anything would get through to Adonis, maybe he would think twice now that he's got a kid on the way and he's literally in the same exact position that his dad was. Even if he doesn't die, you could get seriously hurt.
But that's part of the being a boxer. But you're right. I understand. She's worried about his safety. I understand. It's just to say, I just hope you're there for your child. Well, why wouldn't it be? Even if he got his face caved in, you know, like he's still going to be there for his kid. Win or lose this fight, saying that statement means he's going to not be there, like physically there. Well, yes, he will be. So if he loses and loses badly and ends his career, he'll still be there for his kid. Physically. That's how I took it. The literal not being there for the kids.
That might not be guaranteed. Meaning, you're right. The likelihood is low. However, she's looking at this. This isn't like ranked fighter that we know anything about. It's the same situation. Right. We don't know anything about this guy. They've got something to prove. And clearly, Rocky doesn't think you can do it.
Right. That's fair.
He could get hurt. Like, he could go blind or it could impact his life in a permanent way.
And that actually is a good segue to the Facebook comment we got from this gentleman's name is, I apologize for not pronouncing it properly, Dalbir Sawan. He's from the UK.
He's emailed us before.
Yes, he has. He says, just finished listening to the episode. That was episode 8, Creed 2, episode 8. He goes, regarding the remark that Rocky said things that are broken that haven't been fixed yet, he agrees with Kyle that it's physical trauma, the brain damage, and not psychological issues. My diplomatic response was, interesting. Very cool that people get different things from the same scene. That's interesting that Dalbir has the same feelings as Kyle. You know, and I have a theory, and no, take no offense, Dalbir. I can't speak for Katie, but I know I feel things emotionally very strongly. And how should I say this? Like, and this isn't making me better or worse. I'm saying this in the best way I know how. And if I'm totally wrong about my so I'll just say this. There are people who don't cry in movies, who songs don't make them cry, or they just don't – or like if you're in a situation where somebody is saying something stupid and you feel uncomfortable for that person even though you have nothing to do with that situation. And there's other people who just they don't wear their heart on their sleeves. But I wear my heart on my sleeves. So I'm getting that. All I'm saying is I put myself in Rocky's position. So what Kyle and maybe Dalbir, what they're doing is they're saying if I lost a fight to Drago and like got my head caved in, I'd only be upset that I got physically damaged. I wouldn't be emotionally damaged by the loss or by the injuries. I'm just using the evidence that is there in the Rocky films that, you know, Rocky's been afraid. Things do get into his head. Adrian's support affects his ability. So if you were to actually track Rocky's pattern of behavior psychologically, the fact that his head got caved in by Drago after his friend died by the same person, you would not, I'm saying Dalbir is like this or Kyle, but they're the ones who don't agree with us. So I'm saying you have to be mentally irregular because like think about Rocky's character. He's totally affected psychologically by things. He went on the freaking death date tour of Adrian. Like everything affects him emotionally. I argue again that Rocky's trauma in the ring was absolutely psychological. Wounds heal him very easily. He doesn't worry about the and even the brain damage. He doesn't care that he can't fight anymore. He cares why he can't fight. So things inside of him got messed up that will never heal. So I'm going to double down.
I'm glad because I was actually kind of surprised that that anybody was on Kyle's side with that, because I also felt that it was like uber clear that it was psychological. In addition to all the things you just said, just for drama's sake.
Yeah, like, it's actually more, I agree. If you want to look at just as a writing style, it's more poignant and more dramatic to say that it's physiologically in his head. Drago's in his head. There's no pictures on the wall in the restaurant of that fight. He never talks about it to anybody. He never mentions it in Rocky V, Rocky Balboa. He never talks about this fight because it damaged him. He wished it never happened.
And I think what you're trying to say, Ryan, is that you are an empath.
I am.
As am I.
Yes, I know that about you. Being an empath, I already knew that. And that's how you knew that I was. Yeah. I am an empath. I don't know why I did that.
Happy birthday, Polly.
Yeah, happy birthday. Happy birthday, Katie. Let's keep going. There's a scene right here. I'm explaining what we're seeing here because Katie actually can't see the video because Netflix blocked it from her being able to see it with the sharing. Also for our listening audience, so we've now got Adonis talking to Bianca on the bed and he's kissing her tummy and stuff. Look, I've been with my both my wives who have been pregnant with kids, and you don't really start kissing the stomach or talking to the stomach until there's a bulge, you know?
A bump.
Yeah, I hate it when they do this in movies and stuff, when they talk to the, you know, basically got a sperm and an egg cell. Like, it's like a zygote. You're not talking to anything. Like, nothing hears you at that point. I'm all for talking to the baby when it's, you know, formed as a baby.
Capable of hearing you,
It has the ability to actually hear your voice, and which they've proven it does hear your voice, absolutely. So.
Mm-hmm.
Why are you so stupid?
Good question.
You are tickling me with that fake beard.
Disrespect. What are you saying for us?
No, I'm not your jukebox. I'm not gonna be walking around here barefoot and pregnant and making you sandwiches either.
You hear that? No sandwiches. No singing. Mama just hating on us. You hear that?
What if the baby can't hear?
So what if the baby can't hear? That's what she asked, so that's what she's thinking about right away.
Can what?
Can't hear. No, it can be hereditary, right?
Everything's gonna be fine. I promise.
A couple things. My wife, and I'm sure I've told this to the audience, but if you're listening to the first time or don't remember, my wife's actually an amputee. She was born without her left elbow down. Every time she's been pregnant, she would express this to me every time. She goes, she gets so worried. Oh, I hope my baby doesn't, you know, because she knows what she went through. It's not about I don't want my kid to be abnormal or an amputee like me, because she's a wonderful, capable, amazing woman. Anyone that knows Becky knows that she just, she does everything better than people with two arms, if not three arms. She's just amazing, you know. The only thing she doesn't do is the monkey bars, as I always say.
But she does seem amazing. Like, I saw the dog food, the homemade dog food thing. I'm like, dang.
Yeah,
she's like superwoman.
Yeah, she is. And I'm humble bragging. I don't care. I don't even care what people think. She's amazing. And I'm not saying that just because she's, you know, an amputee, but it just kind of makes it a little bit more crazy amazing that she just, mm-hmm. just does everything. Like, she does all that with one hand tied behind her back. Like, if it would be you and I doing it with one hand, like, have fun. Yeah. So all that being said, but every time she was pregnant, she was worried up into the ultrasound that the child would have all the limbs. She's the first thing she would check. So it's a valid concern that, and an understandable concern that Bianca has, like, will my child be like me? Because I have these genes in my body. We know that cancer and breast cancer for a woman is passed down genetically, and a lot of these things are genetic. So it's very natural for a woman, or especially, you know, the mother, obviously, to feel like, what am I passing on to my child with the things that I have? So that's a very valid concern. Kudos to Sly, who wrote the film, but kudos to the, and he had, I know he had a couple co-writers with him, so, but kudos to the writers for actually making the baby deaf. Cop out. Spoiler alert, you haven't seen the film yet, sorry to your friend, that, yeah, the baby's deaf. So they actually made the baby deaf. I was like, oh, okay, that's actually kind of cool. Yeah, and they did a very good job of that sequence too. It was actually, I was actually surprised that A, they didn't, B, that it actually, they pulled it off without it making it too traumatic. But we'll get to that scene when we get to it, yeah.
Yeah, it's a good one.
Any thoughts on that?
No, I think you covered it well.
I will say it's a good thing that the baby is deaf, because nobody wants to hear Bianca sing. Let's be honest.
Her daughter probably would, but...
I'm just joking. I'm not joking.
This is a privileged thing of me to say, but I think I would rather be deaf than blind.
Everyone's thought that. That's a great discussion. I mean,
but if you're born one or the other, you don't know any difference. So it doesn't.
Well, that's what I say to Becky. I've actually said to her, I said, well, she's told me, I forget how it came up, but she goes, she doesn't know what she would do with a second arm.
She's just lived her whole life that. Yeah.
She goes, that's what I know. She goes, I obviously understand everyone else has two arms. There's times she gets frustrated that she can't do certain things or she needs my help with something. Yeah. She'll get mad about that. But she would actually kind of be creeped out about having her arm fully materialize. And I kind of get it. Imagine just having a third arm.
Yeah. That's a good way of looking at it. Yeah. So
would you want a third arm? In her world, she's gotten to where she's gone with the one. I mean, she does use her other half quite a bit. Like, I say she has one arm, but like I said, she has the elbow up. It's amazing. Like, she'll hold like a measuring cup in the nook of her elbow in the crook of the, like, she'll hold things, and she knows she cuts it. She types with it too. She types with her elbow bone. You know, she uses that as a finger on a keyboard. So she types with two.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy. Yeah, it's cool.
That's impressive.
Well, again, that's just what she knows. She just uses, like, to her, mm-hmm. to navigate that. It's very easy. But if you try typing with your elbow bone, you're going to hit, like, three keys at once or whatever. But she's able to do mm-hmm. it. It's kind of funny. Well, I think it's a good place to stop. I you know, part of me just wants to keep talking because this is it for 4 months. Yeah, I know. What do you want to talk about?
I did want to let you know that I started watching The Wire.
Oh, yeah.
Recommended. Michael B. is really young in it.
Yeah.
And also, I don't remember you guys saying that little Tony, little Duke, is also in it.
Yep.
But he's one of those people that seemingly doesn't age, because that show is on a long time ago and he looks the same as he did in the Creed movies. He is like one of those people that he could be anywhere between like 25 and 45.
I don't know what it is. Like, look at Carl Weathers. You look at Rashida.
Felicia Rashad.
Thank you. She looks incredible. She's 70 almost, or like in these films. Like, she looks incredible. It's amazing.
Yeah, she does.
But you're right. You know, I forget his name. What was his name again in real life? Oh, well.
Okay. I don't remember.
I would know it if I saw it, but I don't remember. Yeah.
Is it Wood Harris?
Yeah. Good job. I believe it's exactly that. Good job. If you are bored while you wait for new episodes from the Going the Distance of Rocky series podcast, well, watch The Wire. Get a couple of the actors from this movie are in The Wire. Incredible show. Some of the technology in the show is dated because it was out a few years back, but the storyline and characters are amazing. What else could I recommend to watch? Watch Yellowstone if you haven't already. Yellowstone, that's a great series. If you want to support the show, I understand that we're going to be off the air for a few months, but we actually got a new patron. Boy, I'm being terrible today. I don't have him ready to go here. To the individual who's my new patron, thank you. Sorry.
You have to give him a shout out next time.
Yeah, I will give him a proper shout out next time. I'm sorry because it came out of left field. It's like, wow, it's great. We haven't got a new one in a while. We did lose one, though. I'll tell you who it is after. I don't want to say it on the air. I know. I'm a little sad, but it's okay. It's okay. I did offer this individual my thank you for their support throughout the months. And I understand we are going off the air for a few months. Maybe they're just going to wait. But again, if you want to support the show, what you're doing is you're helping support the feed. You're actually helping support the Last of the Action Heroes podcast network, because it's not free to host all those shows. And I foot the majority of the bill, quite frankly. And so thank you, everyone. Yeah. All right. I guess we got to wrap up.
You got to take us out, though.
No, I don't. All right. Ding, ding.
All right, so we are here with the Creed cover. Higher. Let's go higher. So let's go there. Let's make our escape. Come on, let's go there. Let's ask, can we stay? Can you take me higher to a place where blind men see? Can you take me higher to a place with golden streets?